Fistral Beach in Newquay, pride of the rugged North Cornish coastline. After one of the wettest, gloomiest and flattest summers on record, Fistral has delivered in all its glory for the most prestigious date on the international surfing calendar, the Quicksilver World Championships. At the height of yet another Indian summer, it's a combination of sun and surf that the organisers had hardly dared hope for. Atlantic rollers crash onto Fistral's craggy rocks, producing perfect conditions for the world's top amateurs. There are more than 200 athletes here from all parts of the surfing world, from the golden stretches of the Copacabana in Brazil, from the volcanic paradise of Hawaii, and from those surfing superpowers, the cocky suntanned Australians and their arch rivals from the Californian beaches of the United States. But there are unknown quantities here too from surfing's third world, the diminutive Japanese, far removed from the surfing stereotype, but soon to prove one of the surprises of the tournament with their kamikaze wave riding. The Scandinavians from much cooler climes wedded to their wetsuits, and of course the emerging British team. For the first time in its 22-year history, the World Championships have come to the United Kingdom. And with two-thirds of the British team from the southwest, there's a feeling that home advantage could be the great leveller.
Yeah, we'll do well. We probably haven't got a chance of winning it, but we are certainly having a go and we're doing our best. And I think we'll put up a good fight. I can see us probably finishing fifth or so in the teams, and individuals probably get some in the top 20.
Once in the water, the modern surfer achieves an almost balletic grace, even under the pressure of top-level competition. To ensure unique pictures of the event, Television Southwest are breaking new ground in a bid to get right into the action. Normally, top surfing events are covered from the beach, but cameramen Rod Sumter and Mark Twitty take their special lightweight equipment right into the waves to shoot some remarkable tracking shots. Although it's a strictly amateur competition, the world's is still big business. Board and wetsuit manufacturers and sunglass makers all peddle the Californian lifestyle, and there are plenty of takers. But the competition is also a crucial step up to the professional ranks. Californian Tom Curren captured the amateur crown in 1982. Now he's the undisputed world number one.
I guess the importance of those events are for the younger surfers who are thinking about being pro. They want to have a good result there just to see how they measure up to the international amateur stars, say from Australia or America. And I think when you go into the professional event, you want to have a good result there just to make sure that you've done pretty much everything you can as an amateur, and the only next step is to turn professional.
So you're saying it's a good springboard?
Yeah, I definitely think it's a good springboard, because it virtually is the last challenge that you could have as an amateur.
At the top level, surfing is a complicated business. The 18 teams here at Newquay are competing as both individuals and as nations. And the 200 competitors must be whittled down to grand finals through a series of complex heats.
There are three competitions from which teams accrue points. At the end of that, you have a points team winners. Then there is a grand final, of which you take the world champion.
So that's the overall framework of the event. But how are the heats organised?
There's four-man heats. So you've got four surfers in the water. There are five judges judging them. They judge on length of ride, manoeuvres, difficulty of those manoeuvres, and that the wave selected is the largest wave of a set.
And am I right in thinking there's a sort of points basis for the winners of those heats?
Yes, 6 points first, 5 second, 4 and 3.
Taking a look out at the water right now. A pretty bit of action over there on the north side of Fistral. Nice little cut back there for the lady serving in right. Picking up a nice looking right hand there. She cuts back down to the bottom of the wave. Nice off the left hand, a nice re-entry there for serving in red, Lisa Anderson, coming back down the face of the wave.
But it has a language which is born out of mythology of surfing from years past, such things as Hanging Ted and Hodad and Cowabunga and the like. But the sort of terminology we're hearing at the World Contest today is really technical terminology describing specific functional technical maneuvers taking place in the water. For example, a bottom turn is simply the surfer striking the bottom of the wave and then redirecting his surfboard with his maximum speed back up towards the top, that is the lip. If he then hits the water coming down at the top of the wave, it's called an off the lip or a re-entry. A radical change of direction from one direction to another in 180 degrees is known as a cutback. And in fact, really, it's still the ultimate maneuver of surfing, really, is if the waves are throwing over, tubing as we call them, then there is the tube ride where he actually sits himself in and under the lip with it throwing over his head.
Board preparation is all important. Like a snooker player with his cue, surfers nurture their boards with care and affection. Over the years, boards have changed dramatically from the 8-foot Malibus beloved by the Beach Boys generation to the much shorter high-tech thrusters now used by the international squads.
This is the wax. This is for us to get a grip on the board because the actual fiberglass is quite slippery and in the water you just fall off. This acts as a device so you can actually maintain a grip on your surfboard while surfing.
And is the wax all the same?
No, there's many different brand names, but on the whole they are similar. They're just different. They've got different colours and smells, but that's the only real difference between them.
If you could just turn the board over and look at the bottom, that's a different kettle of fish altogether, isn't it?
Yeah,
what are these sort of channels cut into the board?
Well, this is a board with four channels. This enables a bit of air to get under the surfboard to give you a bit of lift to create more speed through turns.
Now, I noticed that most of the modern boards, certainly competition boards, have these three fins, don't they?
Yeah. Three fins is just today's accepted general sort of design feature because we've evolved through single fins to twin fins to thrusters, and I think through this evolution we've come to the main sort of design board we're going to use.
And what about the end, the tail, the bit of the board? I mean, that's, most of them seem to have that sort of squared off end now.
Yeah, this is a square tail thruster. This gives you a bit more area in the tail, which helps create more speed. I think, as I say, these boards have evolved a lot in the past few years, and this has again become the more accepted design feature for a surfboard.
At the end of the day, of course, it's the man and not the board which will ensure that world crown. And in the burger bars and beer tents which make up the canvas city high on the Fistral cliffside, everyone's agreed on the wave riders who'll dominate this 1986 World Championships.
Sports, the ladies have tended to take a back seat, but attitudes in surfing are changing.
People say that this is a really good contest for the women, and they've seen really good surfing, better than if they've never seen it. So I think it's getting better and better. And there's a lot more countries coming with women, like Japan, Peru, South America, France. France got four women in the team, so it's getting bigger.
Thank you.
Day 5, midway through the contest, and after 4 days of good surf, Fistral has died for the first time. But the championships are well ahead of schedule, and the calm seas bring welcome relief, and the little-known sport of igloo racing.
Saturday morning down here on the west coast of Great Britain. A very good morning to you if you just showed up at the beach. I'd like to welcome you on behalf of Quicksilver to the 1986 Quicksilver World Amateur Surf Championships. Bright and early down here today, but surf conditions looking near perfect out there in the bay.
We've had, as you know, some quite good surf early on in the contest. It went flat for a couple of days, but with this pumping up for the final 2 days, we couldn't have wished it for better.
Did you really expect the conditions to be this good for the competition?
Well, we planned it for late autumn because we get the good autumn swells coming through. They were a bit late in coming, but now we've got them, we're delighted.
What sort of conditions are the competitors facing out there?
Well, what they're facing out there is a very heavy paddle out through a lot of white water to get out to surf. And when you bear in mind they've only got 15 minutes to do their heats, they've really got some paddling to do.
And what size surf are we talking about now?
Well, at the peak, it's around about 8 to 10 foot, and it's really good, and the Hawaiians are ripping it apart, of course.
Starting to sort out the men from the boys.
It certainly is.
This looks like a good left-hander. Be setting up for a big off the lip here. Comes off the bottom, nice off the top there. Probably a cut back, come off the suit. Now I'm going to start doing some S-turns here. Just looking for the inside reform. Just bouncing, cutbacks. Now more bouncing, just looking for that inside. A little cutback there. Now bounce, I'm going to be setting up for a big off the lip here, right there. Bomb turn off the foam there. Now just keep riding this way.
A little bit mushy on the inside there.
Yeah, definitely. Just really got to be on your toes. Got to really float good. Now it looks like the end of the heat, so I'm deciding whether I should paddle back out or just sit there.
Just off from the bottom, hard off the bottom as I could, up to the top, hit the wash. Coming around, I was just trying to build up as much speed as I can. I'm looking for a section, I think. This wave's starting to build up a little bit more as I'm looking at it now. Now I just started to get off a few more round of turns. It's got a bit of a section here, it looks like. I got off quick, I think, early. Yeah, yep, off.
Setting up for a couple re-entries coming up. I'm getting my feet stable right now. I'm racing down the line. I see a good section coming up. Get my balance and confidence up. And I hit a good re-entry right there. And finish it off right at the end. Didn't finish it all the way through because of the time factor. I had to get back out and get another one. It's a real difficult paddle right now. But that was a good scoring wave. I was pleased to catch it.
Starting to paddle there. This wave, it's in like dying moments of the heat. Paddling into it. Getting up. Looking for as many maneuvers as I can. Cut back. Working up for another maneuver. Another cut back. No one, and now getting some more speed up as I go along. Little manoeuvre there, and looking for the last one. And unfortunately, I didn't make that one, so I lose a few points there.
Pleased with the heat?
Yeah, I was pretty pleased, but I'll just see how it goes.
The lineup of the last 16 is much as expected, but there's a welcome surprise in 12th place on the leaderboard. British number one Paul Russell has made the quarterfinals.
And a nice left-hander. Good turn off the top. He's got a good wave here, slightly overhead, once again critically in the breaking face of the wave. A rebound. Now Paul must keep this board going. He's realised he's bouncing the tail block, trying to get speed to keep it going. And Todd Matsui got a long, long wave outside, but a lot of it broke in front of him. That will dissipate the wave's energy, so it won't quite give him a good a ride as perhaps the last few. But he's milking it for all he's got. He's going left. Nice off the lip. Hard bottom turn.
Thank you.
Well, you got knocked out of the quarters there, unfortunately, and there goes Britain's hopes. But how do you feel about it?
I'm very pleased to have come. I've finished 13th now in the world. I've made the grand final. I'm very pleased. Obviously, I would have liked to get through my heat today, but the waves didn't come to me. It's one of those things in surfing. Sometimes you get good waves, sometimes you don't. They all managed to elude me this morning, so that's that.
Is that result an improvement on the last world titles for you in 84?
Yes, I finished 23rd in California in 84, and I was pleased with that result.
I think a lot of people in the British camp were a bit miffed when they saw you stand up when the klaxon went.
I knew it was all over by then. You actually get scored an interference for standing up on the klaxon, which is what I did. But I knew at that stage it was all over. I just wanted to ride a good wave in, show everybody I could surf.
Did you see Nicky and Doug and Todd working the heat? Did you see how they were doing?
Yes, I gave them a 10-minute head start, actually. I sat out at sea and had a good watch at them. They were all doing very well.
So talk us through it. What were you thinking of there?
Well, I'm coming back towards the curl there, off the top, try and score some points. Another off the top here, this is quite a nice one, that one. Then it's basically going for length of ride from here, staying with the foam. And then, yeah, still going for length of ride here.
You seem very mushy on the inside,
yeah.
Is that right?
And then getting off there, because I need to get back out and get more waves. No good having one good one, you could have four.
So, you're not too disappointed?
No, not too disappointed.
In the event, some of the big names made their exit along with Paul Russell. Haho, Wood, Silver and Slater all took a tumble in the later stages, but the grand final still throws up that familiar battle between those surfing superpowers.
So here we are, the moment we've all been waiting for in these Quicksilver World Surfing Championships. That, of course, is the grand final from the 200 competitors. We've whittled down to just four, the four top athletes in the world in this surfing competition. Wilfred Sanford, Jeff Booth, Mark Sainsbury and Ross Clark-Jones. With me is Rod Holmes. Rod, would you agree that we've ended up with the four best?
I think so, Pete. It's a shame that young 15-year-old Nicky Wood doesn't have a place in the final because he's a very good surfer, very competent, and people have been tipping him to certainly be there. But I think we've got a fair representation of some of the best surfers in the world here for the remaining half-hour final.
Well, an early ride there.
Ross,
looks like in white.
Jeff Booth. Tremendous off the lip, very powerful off the lip on his front forehand. He's a goofy foot. Actually, some of these surfers are described as switch foot, which means they can stand with both their right foot forward or their left foot forward, whatever they choose to. Most surfers go one way or the other. I'm not sure, he may well be a switch foot.
Certainly got a nice long ride there.
Yes, he did. Good opening account. Wilfred Sanford opening and going for that tube again. He's used that tactic in the semis and he's going for it again in the final, and he's somehow finding it. Layback there, small layback. Sits back into the wave, lets the water hold him up and bounces back on his board, but it's a very good wave.
That's the fourth tube we've seen him take, isn't it, in today, so he must be able to spot them. There's no way that's a coincidence now.
Ross Clark-Jones, that's a good right-hander. What a good off the, and a floater too. And off the lip combined with a floater, he fell sideways almost, rather than straight forward on the surfboard as the wave broke. That'd be a high scoring ride.
Does he keep control in conditions like that? Quite amazing.
That's a nice looking right, natural foot. Nice right from Mark Sainsbury. Very radical style. Bumping the board, quite a short board that he's riding, can't be more than 5'10". Good deep section there, inside and comes out, that's a tube. That'll make Wilfred sit up and think. He's playing him in his own game, weaving his way now in the white water, going for a length of ride to top off those good manoeuvres and that cover-up. Bouncing the board, keeping it going. Little snap there, in the white water.
This is good stuff, isn't it, from Sainsbury?
That's excellent.
Jeff Booth, is it not? Yes,
that
it is. Jeff Booth of the States.
It's a good left-hander. See, it's getting oily, that face of that wave now. It's the wind's dying a little. A good cut back. Off the top, bang. He's got such a fluid manoeuvre off the top. The American camp absolutely whooping it up behind us. They're delighted with that move. Look at that pivotal off the top. That back foot is in such good positioning, and he gets covered up. Short tube ride just coming into the shore break on the reform. That is a very high scoring ride, I would think. Yes, yeah, thumbs up. He's delighted with that one. That's going to set the pace, I think. Wave's cleaning up a fraction and dropping back. That's a nice looking wave for Mark. Mark Sainsbury setting up backhand again. Oh yes, that's very good. Good strong off the lip. Setting up for another. Cut back into the white water. That was excellent.
This
pumping
is
the
good
board.
Stuff.
Moving. Two big manoeuvres there. Going to be very high points.
This looks a very tight final as we expected, Rod, doesn't it? We've seen some points piling up for Sanford, Booth, Sainsbury and Ross Clark Jones.
I wouldn't like to say who's anywhere near the lead. It's so close.
Open division champion now in the world. Are you going to turn professional?
Yeah, I hope. Hopefully, I'll be turning pro when I go back to Australia in about a week or so after I go to France. A bit of a holiday.
And how about tonight? What are you going to be doing tonight?
Bit of a rage, I'd say. Full on rage, drinking it up. Bit of beer.